WTBQ.
Good morning. This is Million Dollar Feeling, and I'm your host, Brian Baird, and welcome. We're coming to you from WGHT in New Jersey, WTBQ in New York, and you can listen live from anywhere in the world at WTBQ.com. Or if you want to listen to replays of this show or any of our other shows, just go to MillionDollarFeeling.com and click on the first tab and pick the show you want to listen to. Our theme today is the woman behind the smile and her mission to save the world. And with me today is special guest Debby Montgomery Johnson. Debby, please say hi to everybody.
Hi, everybody. So glad to be here.
I'm so glad you're here, too. So without our sponsors, we can't do the show. So just give me a second here to talk about them. So we have Hudson Valley Kitchen Design Centers, where you can love where you live. They really get you where that spot, where that serves you. That's your home is your palace. Your home is the place you just got to be. And then you have Subtle Energy's Holistic Healing Center, where you can love how you feel. And if you're not quite there yet, they'll help you get there. And if you are already there, they can help you stay there. And then Mike's Auto Care, where you can love what you drive. Doesn't matter how old that car is. He does a great job helping keep that car on the road or helping you make the right decisions if something's not so smooth in that car. So our theme today, just to restate it, is the woman behind the scenes. I'm sorry, woman behind the smile and her mission to save the world. Now, that's a little bit tongue-in-cheek in some sense because I'm overclaiming what Debby does. However, I really want to make sure people are listening to what we're talking about in terms of the theme today. And it starts with the ideas is that so many of us, through no fault of our own, this is not a blame game, but and so many of us are challenged with standing in our power. And I would say probably every one of us at some time has a challenge standing in our power. And what do I mean by standing in your power? You make the right decisions for yourself. You're standing in your truth. You're expressing self-love and self-care, and you're able to trust what's going on around you, and especially trust yourself to make these kinds of decisions. And what happens is that our experiences from the past can traumatize us or put us into a place where we don't always feel comfortable with certain situations, and we may make decisions that are wrapped up in fears or limiting beliefs or even the injuries that took place in the past. And so when that happens, we can get into a little bit of a pickle. And that's kind of what Debbie's here to help me talk about, because has anybody out there either themselves experienced this or known somebody who has experienced? I know of a handful already personally, where somebody may end up with a relationship that's just, you already know from the get-go it's not serving them. Something's not right, yet they can't see it. And so part of what we're going to talk about today is when that goes to the extreme and how it can be an extremely disheartening experience. Debby, can you tell us a little bit about how you got to be the woman behind the smile?
Well, I first want to say to everybody out there that I'm just like you are. I'm a mother, a grandmother, a businesswoman, business person. I've had great experiences in life, great employment experiences. I was an Air Force intelligence officer. I was a bank manager. I had a lot of really good experiences. But I also have been an entrepreneur that was thrown into the business because my husband passed away 10 years ago. Didn't have the training in his business, but I had great resources. And so I was being my old self-sufficient self. I came from Vermont. I would be what I call one of those damn Yankees. And I tried to do everything by myself, for myself, to keep the company running and to keep myself moving on after Lou died. So how did I become the woman behind the smile? I think we are all men and women that hide behind smiles. And I take this back to when I was a kid, no one wanted to hear your problems. And my mom used to say, basically, woman up, which is what I use, woman up. Deal with what you're dealing with, and no one wants to hear you complain. And I found that when I was working in the bank years ago as a manager, I used to tell my staff, when someone comes up to the teller line and they're griping that day, that you just happen to be in front of them. They have something going on in their life. Just listen don't take it personally. And what do? We put on the smile and we just listen. And I've done that my whole life. I wanted everybody to think I had everything in control, and I had a perfect marriage for 25 years, perfect in quotation marks. I had perfect children. I wanted the world to see me the way I wanted them to see me, not the way I might have really been. And so I put up that smile and I hid behind it because I didn't want anybody to see that there were cracks in my life.
Well, this is a pretty powerful thing to say, because I myself, not to make this about me, but I just want to say very briefly, is a lot of my story up until recent years was about an external locus, that I made my world what I wanted the world to see and not what was really happening. And a lot of that is because it's a protective mechanism to look perfect, or to get the adoration or adulation of being perfect, or some appearance thereof. And then the more we do that, the less of our internal self we really have. So so you've had a shift, right? A powerful shift.
I have, but along that line too, I also realized, because years ago, a friend of mine, she was a new friend, she said, "Deb, you know what? I almost didn't reach out to you because someone told me that you were a snob, or that you were unapproachable, or all that." And I'm thinking, that's not me at all. But I guess because I was trying to protect myself from what other people might be saying about what had, happening wherever. Not that it was bad, but I always wanted to look like I had it all together. And when she reached out to me and I said, "Oh, that is not me. I'm totally not a snob. I love people, but I'm very private and I protect myself and I protect my family." And I didn't want to come off as being a snob, but it apparently looked that way. So there have been times in my life where I wanted to protect me, and I wanted to protect my feelings and my children and my husband, whatever he did or didn't do. And so when Lou died, again, I wanted to protect his image, whatever that might have been. He was very bold, a businessman, former intelligence officer. You loved him or you hated him. And I wanted to make sure that people had a good memory of him in spite of the things that might have happened in our marriage. And anybody that's been married for more than a day realizes that marriage is not perfect and it's a two-way street and you've got to do your part. And I felt many times that I did more in it, and I didn't want any contention, so I kept quiet about it. And I learned over the years that you don't need to be a doormat, but you need to be able to stand up for yourself in whatever you're doing, as far as raising children or contributing to a marriage or whatever. And so I had to learn that. And when Lou died, and I had to run his company right off the bat, because that was paying the bills for us, even though I had a job outside, I needed to reach out to other people. I couldn't be that self-sufficient damn Yankee anymore. I needed help, and I needed feedback from clients and from vendors and from whoever, because I needed to keep the company going. Personally, I was at home and I was falling apart because I was putting that smile up so that people thought I had it all together. But when I was home alone at night from 12 to 4 in bed by myself for the first time in 25 years, I was falling apart. I just cried. I was mad at Lou. I was angry at him dying, and that's so silly. How can you be angry at someone for dying suddenly? But I just felt like my life had been rocked, and things that I had planned on were not going to happen. So I needed to shift my perspective and the way I looked at my life and the way I looked at where I was going, and it was tough.
Well, what you describe, I think we've all seen, if not experienced ourselves, right? Where something goes off the rails in our lives, and the resulting emotional upheaval, or maybe downturn, or whatever you would like to call it, can take taking the wind out of our sails and making it a little bit more challenging than it would be when we're trying to present our best selves. And maybe we even overcompensate by continuing to present our best selves when we are really even further in the weeds with our life than we really want to be. I'm talking with Debby Montgomery Johnson, with The Woman Behind the Smile. And our theme today is The Woman Behind the Smile and Her Mission to Save the World. And when we come back, we're going to talk with Debby. She has an amazing turn in her story that you're not going to want to miss. I'm Brian Baird, your host. This is Million Dollar Feeling.
Want that million-dollar feeling? Then tune in every Saturday morning at 9 a.m. with Brian Baird and learn how the language of life and the universe influences you and your life and all those around you. You will be the master of your fate and learn how to let go of your past and create a future filled with great success in life, love, and business with a million-dollar feeling. Get your life in high gear and visit MillionDollarFeeling.com for more information.
The kitchen is the center of your home, a place for gathering, entertaining, enjoying a cup of coffee with a friend, and making memories. Hudson Valley Kitchen Design wants to help you create your ideal kitchen. We offer total service from selection of hardware, custom cabinetry, and countertops, as well as custom packages that include full design, installation, and remodeling services, all with superior craftsmanship and high-quality materials. To get the heart of your home started, visit HudsonValleyKitchens.com.
Clark Howard.
This is Clark Howard.
Every time I use an ATM, I shake where the card goes in to see if there's any looseness to it at all. If there is, I just automatically don't use that ATM.
Clark Howard, weekdays from 1 till 3.
Hi, I'm Dave Edwards, and I invite you to join me every Sunday night when we'll showcase a perfect album. I'll start with side one, track one, and we'll play every song in order from the record. A few bonus songs, as well as some trivia, too, right here on Radio Worth Listening To.
WTBQ.
Welcome back. I'm Brian Baird, your host for Million Dollar Feeling. Our theme today is The Woman Behind the Smile and Her Mission to Save the World. And with me today, a special guest, Debby Montgomery Johnson, who is the woman behind the smile. In our last segment, we got to hear about Debbie's Debbie's story about how she became the woman behind the smile. However, we have some very interesting turns of events. And this just further typifies how we can be amazing people in every aspect of who we are. And then something shows up that we least expect. And there's a surprise in this story. So, Debby, you've already shared this with me, so I'm just going to frame this as an open question and let you just take the run with this. So you've got the story so far. You're a single mom at this point. Your husband's passed away. You're taking over a business that you have previously no experience or knowledge of, or deep knowledge of. Great resources, though. You're smart. You've been very good at showing the world that you've got it all under control. And you actually do, in many ways, hold it under control, except at night, you're just jello on the bed, so to speak. You know, just not who you're presenting to the world. And then your friends start talking to you. Tell me what happens next.
Well, my friends said, Deb, you need to get a life. All they could see was I was working 20 hours a day between my day job and the company. I did get to the gym to swim. They didn't see that when I was swimming, I was crying in the water, which is a great place to let your emotions out, because I could lay, you know, do my laps. But that was where I got control of myself. I did 10 laps of one stroke, 10 of another. I mean, it was very consistent in my swimming, and they didn't see that. But I was trying to get myself physically back together because I had fallen apart. I stopped eating and lost a lot of weight. And for the first time in my life, I was thinking, oh, I'm really skinny now. And one of Lou's friends came up to me, Lou is my late husband. He came into town and he said, you look terrible. You look awful. And I'm thinking, for the first time in my life, I could wear skinny jeans. And he goes, no, you look terrible. You got to get yourself back into good health. And my friend said, you know, you need a life. You need to start getting out of the house. I was running the company from the safety and security of my home, but I was here by myself. I at one point stopped working for the school district because I didn't need to do that job. I was making more money with my company than I was with a whole year at the school district, and I needed to come back home. So, but I had no outside life, no social life, and I wasn't a drinker, I wasn't a smoker, I wasn't a bar person, so I was thinking, how am I going to start dating again? And I was 52 at the time, and all those insecurities of when I was a teenager came flooding in. I wasn't pretty enough, I was skinny enough, but I didn't feel skinny enough. I didn't feel like I could present myself again with perfection to any gentleman at that point. And so that was a shift I had to make in myself, to believe in myself again, to say, okay, you're accomplished, you're smart, you're well-educated, you're well-trained, you've got a good package, you just happen to be a widow and, you know, four kids and all these the things that I thought perhaps others might consider baggage. But so when my friends said you need a life, they meant you get out and date. And they are thinking, well, online dating is a really big thing. This was back in 2010. They said, try it. It's a safe thing. You can do it from the safety, and I keep hitting that word safety, the safety of your home. And so I did. I went online and I looked at the faith-based websites, thinking that that would be a place where I would find good men. And I very carefully put my profile out there and put the good things, I mean, the perfect things. I had good pictures. I had good wording. I thought it was a good, solid profile. And that's how I started my online dating excursions, events, adventures, whatever we want to call them. But then I very quickly realized that the guys over 50, I was looking between 50 and 65, many of them couldn't write, they couldn't speak well, they showed their pictures, they came up in pictures with what I call wife beater t-shirts, and I'm thinking, you know, I was married to a very smart man, and I want someone that can at least write better than a fifth grader. So that was tough to realize that this was going to be a difficult thing. I didn't see the kind of men that I wanted to start dating until I was contacted by a very handsome, good-looking Italian. He was actually from London, an international businessman, and his name was Dr. Eric Cole. And Eric wrote very well, and he was articulate, and he had beautiful pictures of him and his family. And he came online one time on the dating site and sent me a message, say, hey, can we chat? And so we stayed on the website for a little bit. And then he was again, an international businessman. He was going to be getting an assignment overseas. And he was leaving Houston. He was in Houston at the time. He goes, I'm going to be going to the Far East. Can you get onto Yahoo Chat? Well, off the dating site, onto Yahoo Chat. I didn't know anything about Yahoo Chat, so he got me onto it. And I thought it was great because it was instant messaging. And we could be chatting for hours and hours at a time. Chatting, when I say chatting, I mean typing. I typed really quickly, and so did he. But we could be communicating with each other for hours on Yahoo Chat. And it was extraordinary. I had someone that listened to me. I had someone that I could talk with. I could tell everything to him about my disappointments, my excitement, my life as it is, as it was, as it would be. You know, I was planning my future with this wonderful man, and I got drawn into his family. And there were times when he had a son. His name was Kenny, and Kenny lived in England with Eric's sister Mary. And there were times when I would have a Yahoo chat message open with Kenny and Mary, and then I had one open with Eric, and then I got to know his attorney, Peter, and I had a chat box open with Peter. So, you know, four or five people at a time I'd be chatting with. And it was an extraordinary adventure, and it got me out of my funk, my blue funk of being alone and feeling like life was really sad and it wasn't what I expected. So,
well,
a lot.
Yeah, it's not just a lot, though. It's very telling to me that we all need to find that outlet that we can't stay. I mean, especially if you look at kind of like today's times when many of us are kind of sequestered. We really do need to have some outlets that are social in nature and even aligns with our intellectual levels or our hearts and all those other things. So it sounds like in this experience, that's what was arriving for you, was exactly what you needed to get out of that state that you didn't even realize you were in, did you?
No, I thought I was doing just great. There were times when someone would say, how are you doing? Well, that's the worst thing to say to someone who's lost somebody, because that brought up all the sadness and it would make me cry. So I said, if you don't ask me how I'm doing great. But I needed that human connection, but I didn't need the physical connection because, again, I'd been married for 25 years and I wasn't ready for someone in my house, but I was ready for that connection, the heart connection and the security connection. And in a way, I mean, you know, three of my four children were out of the house. They were either in college or in the military. I had my 15-year-old here. And so when I had the opportunity to, you know, kind of mother another little boy, that was fun. And I remember the first time he said, you know, can I call you mom? And part of me was like, you've got to be very careful, because his mom had passed away when he was young. I said, I would love for you to feel that way, that you're comfortable enough to call me mom. And I got to know Mary, his sister. And what I would do is I would ask Mary questions about Eric to try to get to know Eric. And then I would ask Eric questions about Mary and her situation to get an idea of who this family was, because family is very important to me. And I wanted to establish that family relationship as Eric and I progressed online. And I say we were progressing online because, again, he was overseas. He was an international businessman. He was moving hardwood trees from Malaysia to India. I knew that business because I had investments down in Costa Rica, which he didn't know about at the time. But it was kind of interesting that I had an idea of what he did. And I knew international business in a way that I could understand what he was doing. There were many things that I didn't understand. So he and I would have discussions about what's going on. What kind of business are you doing? What are the pitfalls with customs, with tariffs, with all these things? And having the legal background I did, whenever he had a problem, I would look it up. I would Google it. I would find out from business people, what does this mean? You know, when we needed a power of attorney. I'd done multiple powers of attorney for myself and for clients. But when we were doing one with his attorney in England, it was a little more expensive and it was a little more involved. And I'm thinking, why is this so difficult? And the reason we needed that, because Eric was involved in this huge job overseas. And as many business people know, sometimes you don't get paid for that job until the job is completed. And that's what was happening. He had this job and he was going to get paid later on. So there were times when he had difficulty with some finances. And because we had gotten to know each other like family, and I would do anything for my family, I started helping Eric a little bit at a time, but then it got to be bigger and bigger and bigger. And that's where the story really got twisted.
Well, let's leave that story portion for the next segment of our show. I just wanted to recap for people. I'm speaking with Debby Montgomery Johnson. She's the woman behind the smile and her mission to save the world. And so far what we've learned about Debby is that she's articulate, she's smart, affable, knows what she's doing in so many ways, knows how to present herself and get her act together, and at least people think so. That she went through a period where people thought she was arrogant or aloof or snobby, as was your language. And I can identify with a lot of these personally, Debbie, because of things that were in my own life over the years too. So it's easy for me to see that this is probably not unique to me and me, right? So in our discussion with the woman behind the smile, Debby Montgomery Johnson, we so far also learned that her friends had recommended that she get out of her funk, that they recognized that she didn't even see quite, and she began online dating and found this remarkable man named Eric. And Debbie, just to maybe give people a hint, or maybe it's not a hint, maybe it's not a fair hint. You're married now, right?
I've remarried. That's the great hope out of this situation.
So when we come back, we'll find a little bit more about your story and how it led to where you are today and the power that you now have in sharing your story and getting other people out of their funks as well. So I'd like to just draw attention to one thing. People are not going to be able to see what I see. I want to describe Debby a little bit. She is, and this is not about your looks per se, it's about your air. Does that make sense? Because I don't really think it's fair to talk about people's looks anyway, although you look remarkable. So Debby has some upcoming work that's dealing with the fact that she wears pearls a lot. And I wanted to sort of say, she's on the air with me and she's wearing pearls. So that gives you a little bit of story about how she is packaged. She's just amazingly a packaged person. I'm Brian Baird. I'm your host. And this is Million Dollar Feeling. We'll be right back.
Settle Energies offers a wide variety of bodywork, energy work, classes, events, and lectures to create a path on your journey to a life of holistic natural health. Settle Energies offers massage, aromatherapy, homeopathy, and classes that include Tai Chi, drum and flute circles, and so much more. To begin your journey to a healthy mind, body, and spirit, visit their website and contact them for a consultation at Settle Energies Health.com. www.MillionDollarFeeling.com.
Want that million-dollar feeling? Then tune in every Saturday morning at 9 a.m. with Brian Baird and learn how the language of life and the universe influences you and your life and all those around you. You will be the master of your fate and learn how to let go of your past and create a future filled with great success in life, love, and business with a million-dollar feeling. Get your life in high gear and visit MillionDollarFeeling.com for more information.
Orange County Family Court Judge Carol Klein has 30 years of proven judicial experience and a lifetime of compassionate service to children and families. Even with more than 50 endorsements from state, county, and local leaders, Family Court Judge Carol Klein isn't about politics. She stands for the children. Vote to re-elect Orange County Family Court Judge Carol Klein on June 23rd, the only candidate with the judicial experience that Orange County needs.
Paid for by citizens for Judge Klein.
Hi, this is Dan Baldwin, host of Instant Replay, a sports talk radio show on your favorite radio stations, WTBQ and WGHT. Join me from 12 to 2 p.m. every Saturday to break down all the latest news and games in all of sports. Call in to agree or disagree with me on radio worth listening to.
Hi, it's Paul Ruskevich,
Barry Cheney,
and John Vero.
Orange County legislators on the Thursday morning roundtable, 9 to 10 a.m.
Answering all of your questions and concerns
on WTBQ, radio worth listening to. WTBQ
weather. For this afternoon, we'll have a mix of sun and clouds with a cold front moving through. Watch for a brief shower or thundershower in the mid-80s. Tonight, mainly clear and comfortable, 50 to 55. Sunday, sun mixing with a few afternoon clouds, breezy at times, but pleasant with low humidity in the mid-70s, and dry weather with sunshine Monday. From the WTBQ Weather Center, I'm WeatherWorks meteorologist John Leo. WTBQ.
Welcome back. I'm Brian Baird, your host for Million Dollar Feeling, and today I have special guest Debby Montgomery Johnson, who is the woman behind the smile, and I describe it as somebody with a mission to save the world. And in past segments, we were learning about Debbie's loss of her husband and holding it all together in her life, and then her friends recommending that she get herself back out there and kind of get out of the funk that she didn't even quite realize she was in, because she was so busy masking things and protecting herself that she was kind of living the way she was presenting herself in a little bit of an invisible way to the real identity of who she's been. And while she's out there on this, out there in the universe, she does some online exploratory and she meets this amazing guy named Eric. And he was a doctor in England and was doing some international business. And Debbie was meeting family members of his and having amazing, uplifting conversations, which was very restorative. Right, Debbie?
It was therapeutic. Absolutely. It was amazing.
So there was amazing stuff happening by knowing Eric. And maybe it's fair that I just ask the question in this following way. Where did the story go from here?
Well, it was a love story from afar. It was an extraordinary experience. And when I say it was therapeutic, I didn't realize how much I really loved to write. And I had a friend after Lou passed away, she came to me and she said, you know what, for those 25 years you were married, Lou was such a bold and brazen guy a lot of times. She said, you felt like you hadn't been heard. And if you think of your body as a piece of Swiss cheese with the holes in it, I had a big hole that felt like it, that hadn't been listened to. And so with Eric, because it was an online relationship, we wrote to each other daily for hours and hours and hours. And so by him doing that and me writing back, I could express all those things that I couldn't do when I was married with Lou. And so that big hole in me, little by little, started getting filled up, which was really powerful for me. And I felt like I was being listened to. And it didn't matter what we talked about, family, faith, finances, you name it, we talked about it. And it was extraordinary. And here's another, I'm a very big proponent of writing your journal, which I did for 2 years, every single day. I have 4,000 pages of journal to prove, you know, what we went through those 2 years. And it was an extraordinary adventure. I became part of his life, he became part of mine. And with that, I think we've talked about a little bit of the story. You know, he asked me to help him financially, and that damn Yankee comes back. I don't give money freely to just anybody. I do give to my family if they need it. I was very generous with friends. And so Eric would ask me to help him with his business because I felt like the sooner he could finish up, the sooner he could come home. And I trusted what he said. I had no reason not to trust what he was telling me. I had only heard good things about online dating and about relationships friends had had. And so I willingly helped him with his company over 2 years. It was a 2-year online relationship. And I don't know where you want me to go with that, but.
Well, so, I mean, you're giving some hints here that things weren't all as they appeared. And it's fair to say that the money wasn't, at least in the beginning, it wasn't a lot. It was just a little here, a little there, something that was easily within reach and means, and seemed very warranted because you had made all these connections and all these supportive connections to keep everything going. So I'm going to ask you first just to say, was it a story or was it real? And if it was a story, what was it? If it was real, what happened? In fact, it was probably both, right?
Well, it was an extraordinary story. And I felt it was real. I mean, people say, were there any red flags? And I said, well, there were what I call pink flags. There were a few things that happened that I sent a package to England to Mary and to Kenny, and it got returned. I sent a package to, I believe it was probably Hong Kong at the time. He was at a hotel in Hong Kong. It got returned. Things that nothing he ever said to me, I questioned really. But there were times when I'm like, you know, that just doesn't sound right. It doesn't feel right. But again, I had no reason to not trust what he was saying. I put myself around good people my whole life and people that I trusted. And I am in business with people that I don't see, but I trust they're going to do the right thing. And so for those 2 years, we had our ups and downs. It was very emotional. There were times when I, you know, got him hotel rooms to come here to the States. He was coming at Christmas and we had everything planned. And right before he was to come, something happened with the transaction overseas and he couldn't come. So I did have those emotional highs and emotional lows, but when I questioned what was going on, he always had plausible reasons, had good answers. And again, I had no reason not to trust what he was telling me until 2 years into it, when he came online one morning and was writing to me and said, Deb, how do you feel about forgiveness? Well, we had talked about spiritual things through those 2 years, and I put on my spiritual hat and I started telling him how I felt about forgiveness. It went on for hours and we got disconnected, which was not something unusual given where he was, or I thought it wasn't unusual. He came back later on and he said, do you remember what we were talking about? And I said, yes. So we revisited forgiveness. And then finally I was like, Eric, did I do something wrong? You know, why are we talking about forgiveness? And that's when he came back on and said, I have something to tell you. He says, I have something that's going to hurt you, but I need to know that you can forgive me. And at that point, I'm thinking, if it's going to hurt me, I don't know that I really want you to tell me. And he goes, I have a confession to make. And that's when I got that gut punch, because I'd heard that specific wording once in my marriage, and it wasn't very positive, but I dealt with it. And I'm thinking, I don't really want a confession right now. And he goes, I have to confess to you that this has all been a scam. And I'm looking at those words going, what in the world do you mean this has been a scam? This has been my life for 2 years. I said, you must be sick. What is going on there? Is there something wrong? He goes, no, this has all been a scam. And I said, you're lying. I said, now you need to prove to me that what you're telling me is the truth. Because I was emotionally and financially and just all wrapped up into this man. And he said, I will come on live on Yahoo chat. And I'm thinking, for 2 years, I've asked you to come on live and you've told me that it's not possible. He goes, I'm going to walk you through how to set this up. So I, on my screensaver of my computer, I have my handsome Brit, and I'm expecting to see my handsome Brit. And this little camera in the corner of my computer pops up this live feed, and I'm looking at this dark-haired, dark-eyed, dark-skinned young man with a big smile on his face. And I'm thinking, oh my gosh, what has just happened here? And he's acting like there's nothing wrong. And you know, but it in an instant, you know, my heart that belonged to Eric is now looking at this young man thinking, oh my gosh, what has happened? And I pulled out my camera. I don't know how I was able to do that. And I took a picture of my screen. I took a picture of that young man. And I found out that that young man is actually, his name is Joseph, and Joseph was from Nigeria. And nowhere in those 2 years had I ever heard Africa, Nigeria, anything like that. And thank goodness that, you know, with, this is my gift from God, that in an instant, my heart and my head were disconnected from what had happened. And that's when my logical head popped in, my Air Force intelligence head, my banker's head, and I'm thinking, how am I going to get my money back? Because I hadn't told you this. Over those 2 years, I had given him quite a sum of money, which I didn't have in my bank account. But because he was family, I found a way to get it to him. And you're sitting there going, are you going to tell me? She's going to tell me.
Is there a price tag on this relationship that you?
Yeah, it was priceless. It was priceless. But over 2 years, I had sent to him $1,080,763.
Okay, so let's take a pause on that. Let's just take a deep breath. Let's take this all in. $1,080,000.
Yeah, it's like 666,000 bags of peanut M&Ms. Put it in perspective.
What an image.
Yeah, well, yeah, $1,080,762, which I didn't have, but I found it. I was 52 at the time, you know, so I had retirement accounts. I had investments. I had gold jewelry that I ended up selling. There were things, because he was such a part of my life, I wanted to get him home. And I knew that when he got here, I'd be taken care of financially, which was that security button that I had, you know? I trusted who he was. I had, again, no reason not to trust it,
right,
from what I had.
It had what you called the pink flags.
Yeah.
Which if you had been talking to your friends, they might have said, oh, that doesn't sound right. And they might have made him more red-like, but you were...
Well, my friends tried to stop me, and that's the problem with once you've gotten involved in something like this. It's very difficult for anybody to stop you or to make you believe that the person you're talking to is not real.
Okay.
It's very difficult.
So this typifies something that I talk about on the show regularly, which is the difference in the experience of confirmation bias, which means we always look for things to support where we intend to be or feel we should be and or what we believe. And then the other area of called cognitive dissonance, which means when evidence shows up to the contrary, we sweep it away because it's not connecting to what we want to believe. And we see that all around us in various things, of, you know, political discourse or Facebook or conspiracies. And in your case, this amazing story about a relationship with somebody who purported to be Eric and turned out to be Joseph. I am Brian Baird. I'm speaking with our special guest, Debby Montgomery Johnson, the woman behind the smile and her mission to save the world. And it's been an extraordinary story so far. We've had Debby has been completely forthright in talking about the fact that she was a person who liked to make sure she presented the very best of her life to everybody and kind of kept the private things private. And then ended up losing her husband and having to hold it all together and do the same exact behavior for that, all intents and purposes. However, friends suggested she kind of break the pattern and go out and find a new person to make her life a happy life. And in the process of doing so, she met somebody which we just learned had scammed her out of $1,080,762 and some change, I think. So, we'll be back to talk more about Debbie's story because it's still got, we have some more power in what's been happening here to share with you. I'm Brian Baird, your host. This is Million Dollar Feeling.
Mike's Auto Care Center in Goshen is a full-service preventative maintenance and automotive repair center offering high-quality and guaranteed service you can trust at a fair price with a 1-year limited mileage parts and labor warranty. Mike repairs both domestic and foreign vehicles. With 5-star reviews and customer testimonials, Mike's Auto Care Center is one of the most trustworthy auto repair shops in the county. So visit mikesautocare.com and get your car running.
Want that million-dollar feeling? Then tune in every Saturday morning at 9 a.m. with Brian Baird and learn how the language of life and the universe influences you and your life and all those around you. You will be the master of your fate and learn how to let go of your past and create a future filled with great success in life, love, and business with a million-dollar feeling. Get your life in high gear and visit MillionDollarFeeling.com for more information.
Hi, this is Peter Fellow of A&T Healthcare, your one call for the finest in home healthcare. Tune in every Thursday at 10 a.m. to hear the latest news on everything health-related because your health does matter. That's Health Matters every Thursday at 10 a.m.
Hi, this is Walt Baby Love. Start your Sunday with me at 6 a.m. and Gospel Tracts. I'll give you the phone number to the Faith phone line and the address to the website. All that and much, much more right here on Gospel Tracts with yours truly, Walt Baby Love.
WTBQ.
Welcome back. I'm Brian Baird, your host for Million Dollar Feeling. With me today is very special guest, Debbie. How are you doing, Debbie? Debbie.
I'm good.
Debbie Johnson. And in fact, I like Debbie better. Is that okay if I change your name?
You can call me Debbie.
So Debbie Montgomery Johnson's the woman behind the smile. And we're talking about her mission to save the world. Now, why is she trying to save the world? Because there's a certain amount of what we just learned in her story, that she was a person who had her act together, lost her husband, maintained the story of having act together, and then as friends gave her, I guess we'll even say, permission to step out into the world in a different way, she ended up with this amazing online experience with a gentleman named Eric that turned out to be Joseph. And the price tag for that experience was $1,080,762 and some change. However, it's not about the money, is it, Debbie? No.
Not at all. No, I always say that my last suit has no pockets, so I'm not taking the money with me.
Right. So what is, like, it would be real easy at this point to just collapse, right? It would be real easy just to throw in the towel because you have been betrayed in the most profound way, with your heart being misappropriated, your funds being misappropriated, your identity in many ways being misappropriated, because this person was putting you in a box that didn't actually exist, right?
Exactly. I could have hidden under a rock at that point. And talk about being the woman behind the smile. That's when I really put the smile on and pretended to the world that I was fine. And now it was worse than when Lou died, because here I had my heart ripped out from underneath me, but I also had my finances taken away or given away. And I was one that was where my safety was always after Lou died. Cause here's a tip information I didn't tell you. Right before Lou died, he had canceled his life insurance. He'd been paying for 30 years. And he went over the age group. So the premium went from $100 to $500 a month. And he was not going to pay that. And I'm like, well, we've got four children. We can't get rid of our life insurance. But I wasn't going to fight him on that. He goes, oh, we've got investments and all this, and not a problem. So when he died, suddenly, I had no life insurance. So my financial safety was the company, which I needed to learn how to run. And so when Eric came along, the financial safety was coming with him. He assured me that we were going to be together and that we were going to be fine, and that what I was giving him, lending him, was going to be returned to me as soon as he got here. So that was the importance of getting him here. And when that all fell apart, again, I still had to keep the company going, more so now than ever. But I went to the FBI and I reported what happened, and we all watch TV. The FBI can do anything. And when they heard the story, they said, Deb, first off, more men in Palm Beach County get taken for over a million than women, and they never talk about it, but there's nothing we can do for you. And that's when I just shut down. And my parents were with me here, and I said, you know what? I can't tell anybody. I'm just so embarrassed. I feel so guilty. All these terrible emotions, shame and everything. I'm a smart person. This should never have happened to me. And when that took over for a couple of years, it wasn't until I was with our group, the Women's Prosperity Network, went down to speaker training, and one of the girls at lunch mentioned online dating, and I rolled my eyes at her, and I don't do that very often, and she says, Gib. And that's when I told her the story, and she goes, you have to tell the world. I'm like, oh, absolutely not. I'm not telling anybody else. Well, over that lunchtime, multiple women came to me and said, you have to tell because my mom was taken for $80,000, or I was in a relationship for a year with a man and it turned out he had another family somewhere else. You have to speak up. And the more I heard that over that weekend, I crafted a message about the woman behind the smile, and I was going to actually do my own movie. And I said, now is the time for me to take what happened, what bad happened to me, and turn it into good. And not be the woman behind the smile anymore, be the woman with the smile. But go out there and let it all out. Be as completely vulnerable and open as you can, because it's not the naysayers you're going to talk to, because there are plenty. I was going out there because I had a message to just one woman out there that was either involved with an online dating thing or had been scammed, and they needed to know that they weren't alone anymore. That gave me the power. And so from the inside out, I was going to be able to really empower myself and then empower others to know that there's hope, that you'll get through it, and that there are other people out there that are wise, smart, well-trained, intelligent, not desperate, lonely, bumpkin somewhere. These are men and women that are so well-trained that they've just had something happen in their life emotionally, or, you know, you're at a point, and most people are going to be that way. And you've dealt with that. You deal with people that are in a vulnerable
right.
position.
Well, and I, to some smaller degree, I've had this, some experiences you have. It's not nearly as profound in terms of depth, length, or price tag, but I've had relationships with people where it felt like I was putting all the cash into the situation, and then ultimately, and I actually have personal friends in my life who, you know, came home to an empty apartment and an empty bank account. So, and that's happened to at least two people in my network. So, it's not a unique story. It's in fact, and I'd like to kind of draw attention to two things that may be very, very important to point out. Is that there was some silver lining in this experience, because during those 2 years you were filling that Swiss cheese hole you talked about. That's one of it. And another one may not be so much a silver lining, but it was an interesting twist. Didn't the young man Joseph make a declaration? Didn't he have his own kind of turnaround and something in part of his confession that was, you know, a little bit different than, hey, I just scammed you? He had some feelings towards you, right?
Well, he did. And the most amazing thing to me, and I'm really, I guess if I can be grateful to him for anything, first off, it was allowing me to speak up for those 2 years, but also that he confessed and he did it in person and I saw him. Because most scammers just walk away and they leave you hanging. And if that had happened, I would have felt like it was worse than Lou dying, because like I said, now I was invested in him. So yeah, I asked him, I said, why did you do this? Why did you confess? And he said he confessed because he had feelings for me, he'd fall in love, whatever it is. And I've had people say, well, that's part of the scam. I said, that might have been part of the scam, but most of the scammers don't come online in person and show themselves to you.
Very different ending than most of them, definitely.
Definitely.
Now, you've got this mission to save the world. And part of this is to make note that the more we stay in our place of shame, if we become this kind of, I'll use the word victim, the inability for us to heal, that's part of it. And then the second thing is you've also got some words about maybe paying attention to the pink flags a little differently too.
Well, absolutely. And if you're in an online dating relationship, but first off, if anybody asks you for money, period, you say no. You know, it's got to be your choice. And have a dating buddy. If you're going to get onto online dating, have a dating buddy, because someone that's outside of the emotions is going to see what's going on a lot better than you. And the scammers try to isolate you from everybody so that you're only listening to them. Just be aware. If it sounds too good, it is too good. And one thing, as far as the pictures, anybody in military uniform, online dating is a scammer. He's a scammer. The military are not allowed to be there. So just do your due diligence. Look to see, you know, who are their friends. And they're very creative. These online scammers are businessmen. Their job is to get your money, and they do it very well. They have playbooks. They know what to say to you. They know how to get your emotions wrapped up into them. And just be wary of it. I think online dating has its place, but just be careful, because you've got to protect yourself, and the online dating sites are not going to protect you. When this happens,
how do people get past the stigma or shame of being conned? I mean, it really is a con, right?
So it is a con.
Yeah. So how, I mean, you yourself for a short period, or a fairly decent period of time went under a rock because you just didn't, this was such an embarrassing thing to you. Because it won, remember, you've shared with us that a lot of what you did was you presented the best of what's going on for you. And now your story was just so different that that was even challenging for you to do, right? You right. really became the woman behind the smile in a very, very overt, extraordinary way because the shame was there now that wasn't there before. How did you get past the shame?
I had to realize that if I spoke up, I could be there for one other woman in the world. And that was my goal, prevent and protect or educate and then help them to recover. And the more I spoke up, the more people came to me and said, this happened to my mom or this happened to me. And now they knew that they weren't alone. And I was there to give them a hand to hold. And that's my goal. I work with an organization called SCARS, which is a Society for Citizens Against Relationship Scams. I've got my own nonprofit called the Women Behind the Smile. I've been to India, which is amazing because that was part of my story with Eric. I've worked with Women's Prosperity Network. I've worked with women around the world because this is an international problem. And the reason the scammers are getting away with it in such big numbers is because we don't speak up and we don't let anybody know that it's happening. And they're going to the bank because we keep quiet. Okay. So my goal is to just educate those that are around us so they don't get pulled into this.
Okay, so I'm hearing, and by the way, we'll put it on Million Dollar Feeling, how people can go to SCARS as well as to find you and have a conversation with you, as well as you have a special event coming up. So we may want to talk about that very, very briefly. How about I just want to sum this up. So you have this huge passion for helping people, see the light before it gets into some serious hot water for themselves. And then if they have been already a victim of this, that one, they're not alone. And two, telling their story is where the healing is, not keeping it contained. Because when you keep it contained, it just holds everything in, which is not a healthy thing. So okay. Let's talk about your event because, it's a pretty powerful event coming up.
Well, I have a show. Is that what you're talking about? I have a weekly show. We have a show called Stand Up and Speak Up, and it's a live show on Thursday mornings, 9 o'clock Eastern time. Okay. You can get to that through the Women Behind the Smile /show. But we showcase, you're going to be one of my guests, which is great. Right. I'm giving hope and education to many of the women that are part of SCARS, but to the world on how to move forward, how to drop the mask and know that we're not perfect and that there are things we need to learn and to be happy about learning and to share.
Okay. I would like to know if you'd be coming back. I think we need to hear more of what you were sharing with us today and maybe even, share some more advanced avenues for this kind of, we really didn't get enough time to dive into all the appropriate curative manner steps that we can take for this process. I've had special guests with me, Debby Montgomery Johnson, the woman behind the smile. Our theme today was her mission to save the world as the woman behind the smile. And I just want to remind our audience, if you want to find out more about Debby, her Thursday morning show, or maybe even SCARS, which is a place to go if you've already been a victim or you know somebody who's been a victim or is being victimized. You can get there's a lot of amazing resources at the SCARS site. I'll make sure those are on milliondollarfeeling.com. So as I do with every show, I want to wrap up with making sure everybody goes out there with the following steps. Be kind. Be healthy, have fun, and create a great life. This is Million Dollar Feeling.